español?
Sí, claro, ¿cómo está, amigo?
¿Cómo te sientes después de tu debut y este triunfo en este momento en el UFC? ¿Cómo te sientes?
Me siento... no sé. No hay palabras para decir cómo me siento, amigo. Yo dije esto cuando peleé por Contender Series, pero yo he soñado este momento desde que era niño. Entonces, no se siente como la gente dice hartas veces que, oh, esto no se siente real. Esto se siente real. Yo he visto este momento mil veces en mi cabeza, en mi mente. Yo he soñado este momento, entonces es lo que he soñado. Entonces, no sé, yo he trabajado para esto, para estar aquí desde los 14 años, entrenando todos los días, todos los días. Ay, me acuerdo, no, yo no iba a la escuela para ir a entrenar. Entonces, no sé, amigo, esto se siente real.
Un momento que tu rival parecía que te llevaba un poco por delante, era, ¿cómo capiste el temporal ese de los golpes que tenía tu rival para poder imponerte?
Sí, entre el primer y segundo round hicimos los ajustes que tocaba hacer. Mi coach, James Krause, es el mejor coach, en mi opinión, del mundo. Y él va a ser el coach del año. Y él hicimos los ajustes que tocaba hacer entre el primer y segundo round y por eso gané la pelea.
Jeff, I'm sure you answered some of this just then, but what are your initial thoughts after an insane fight like that?
You don't know Spanish, man? No, I'm just kidding.
I do. I just want to give you the opportunity for answer.
Yeah.
What's up, Oscar?
What was the question, brother?
Initial thoughts after an insane fight like that.
Fuck, dude. I probably shouldn't get hit that much in the head. No, I'm kidding. It was a good fight, man. I made the proper adjustments in between the first and second round because my coach, James Krause, my primaries weren't working, so we had to go to something else. And, man, James Krause is going to be the coach of the year. And he told me what to do, and we made those adjustments, and that's what won me the fight.
Well, looking at that third round, I mean, he kind of looked like he just abandoned head movement. Like, his defense was just connecting with his forehead. Have you ever hit someone that much and have them not go down?
No. I was kind of just treating it like a heavy bag. You know, it was like, don't put too much into everything. But whenever I heard my corner say, smoke it. Yeah, send it. Like, I'm trying to put you on your ass. So it was a lot of pity pack, just kind of touching his face, man. With 4-ounce gloves on, you don't have to hit hard. When I teach a kickboxing class, and I tell these guys, with 4-ounce gloves on, like a 7-year-old girl can knock you out, man. She hits you in the right spot, the right time. It doesn't take a lot of power, and obviously there's knockout power that does exist, but with small gloves, you don't have to hit hard, so it's a lot of that pity pat is what sets up the big shots, and it worked.
Between rounds 1 and 2, it looked like you had a little bit of a stare down in there when you were walking back to your corners. Did you guys say anything to each other?
I don't think we speak the same language, but I don't remember me saying anything. It's just, you know, it's a fight, dude. The same fucking golf. Yeah, you know, I'm in there to do violent things, and I'm sure he's in there to... Man, this guy's trying to knock me out in front of my mom. My mom's watching this, and I'm trying to do the same to him. So, kill or be killed, you know?
It looked like, from what I remember, you had dropped him twice. I think it was like a straight right, like kind of clipped him into the jaw, and he dropped. Was that a technique you knew you could take advantage of specifically, or you just saw it open right there?
Again, Coach James Krause, Krause of the Year. He's not looking, but... Oh. I got hit in the head. he smoked the 32. I'm giving away details, but that's what I did, man. And I smoked it and sat him on his ass. And there's always what ifs in MMA. Like, what if there would have been 10 more seconds? For sure, I would have had him out of there. He was pretty hurt, but there wasn't, you know. But that did win me that second round. And again, TJ.
Then I see your corner walking around with that looks like a handle howler head. Was that a present from Dana?
That was a present from Laura Senko, maybe? Or I'm not sure. Yep, Sorolenko.
And then finally, actually two more. What did you think of the fans being back? They were pretty out of control for like right out of the gate.
Yeah, it was fucking awesome, dude. It was sick. My teammate and good friend, Julian Marquez, may have heard of him. He told me he calls it a cheap pop, like get energy from the crowd. I've never... really been one to like feed off the crowd, but I was like, hey man, I'll try anything once. So I did that. Before I got in the cage, I just rose my hand up, and I felt something. I don't know if it was placebo from him saying that you'll feel something, but there definitely was a pop that ran through my body. You know, it was like, it sounds cliche, but yeah, I felt something. I don't know if it was just me about to get into a fist fight or if it was the crowd going crazy, but felt good.
And finally, when do you want to get back in there? Is there a specific name you want to fight, or what are your plans for the rest of the year?
Man, I want to stay active. I was supposed to fight, so I fought for Contender Series in August. It was scheduled for November. Opponent caught the vid, rescheduled to January. I caught the Rona, and dude, shit sucked. You know, it was like back-to-back camps, and I was kind of being a bitch about it. It was like, I felt like I was riding momentum from Contender Series, and this is a what-have-you-done-for-me-lately sport. So if you don't fight for over a six-month period, I think it was 8 months for me, like, people forget who you are. And I was really riding that momentum, and I kind of allowed myself to be a bitch about it and get down on myself. And, you know, I had a talk with, the man, James Krause, and it was like, dude, I didn't lose my contract. I'm still in the UFC, and one day I will be able to have my debut and do the stuff I've dreamt of since I was a kid. So I want to stay active. I took a little more damage than I wanted to in this fight. I want to be able to read books to my kids when I'm older, my future kids. So I need to make some adjustments to not get hit in the head that much. But I want to stay active. I'm fucking rambling right now, but I want to stay active. Hopefully, I turn 24 in July. Maybe get one in around that time.
Over here, Jeff.
What's up, boss?
You talk about that second round knockdown. How much confidence do you feel? Because you said you had some swag when you came out in the third round, and we know what happened in the third round. Did that give you confidence? Not that you were lacking, but with seeing him on his ass, and then he dazed. You know, you were dazed too, but seems like
I wasn't. No, I'm just kidding. Yeah.
But seems like you fed off of that. Is that accurate?
Yeah, sorry. Yeah, hell yeah. Of course, man. Nothing like sitting someone on their ass to be like, oh, I gotcha. So yeah, 100%. Just a little confidence booster. Anytime you can put someone on their ass, it definitely brings confidence.
How much excites you the fact that you didn't fight the most technical fight and you lit a tell about it and you got some stuff to go to the drawing board to improve for next time?
Yeah, absolutely, man. Cage time is valuable, especially at the highest level. I'm here fighting the best people in the world. Again, something I've dreamt of since I started in this sport. So cage time is valuable, but I also don't want to be getting hit in the head that much. I want longevity in this sport, so we're going to make the adjustments, man. Again, I got the best coach in the world. We'll make the adjustments, and we'll only get better.
Do you think the fight was different with the crowd factor? Fact, if you had the same type of style fight with no crowd, do you think y'all would have had this crazy, not rock'em sock'em robot fight?
Yeah, probably. Man... don't get me wrong, having the crowd back, fucking awesome, sick. But I don't care if I'm fighting in front of 15,000 people or Dana White at the Contender Series where it's quiet, or if it's in my backyard. I'm trying to fuck you up regardless. You're trying to do the same to me, so I'm not going to try any extra or more because of who's out there.
If I'm watching me, does this give you motivation to be a slicker fighter? Because everybody think getting hit is cool. Can you let them know how cool it is to get hit?
It's not that cool, guys. It's not that cool. My style is usually that slick, touch you. The name of the game is to hit, not get hit. I didn't do a very good job of that tonight, but, you know, I'm going to learn from this.
Jeffrey, al final del tercer asalto, cuando estaba terminando la pelea, te dieron duro, te sentiste mal, te recuperaste rápido. ¿Cómo te sentiste en ese momento?
Sí, no te voy a decir mentiras, él me pegó duro al último, pero me sentí, pues, bien. No... Todavía estaba ahí, pero sí fue un golpe duro, pero es parte de lo que hacemos, ¿no? Estamos en una pelea, entonces sí me pegó duro.
¿Qué significa tu victoria para otros guerreros latinos y qué significa tener a Julián Márquez ahí de compañero?
Se siente, no sé, ser hispano, ser latino es algo que está en nuestro corazón, como es un orgullo que es como natural, como... No sé cómo explicarlo, pero no hay palabras para describir cómo se siente para ser latino y estar en el nivel más alto del deporte. Mis papás son todo para mí. Han sacrificado mucho desde que llegaron a este país para ir mi hermano y yo. Y pues, no sé, es algo, un orgullo... no hay palabras para decir cómo se describirlo, pero tener a Julian como un compañero, es él estaba en este deporte casi el mismo tiempo que yo, pero él ha tenido más experiencia en el UFC, entonces él es como un hermano mayor. Yo le pregunto cosas como cómo se siente estar con los fans y cosas así, y él me dice, y pues yo lo uso cuando yo peleo.
¿De dónde son tus papás? Porque tú tienes la bandera, ¿no? Sales siempre con la bandera. ¿De dónde son tus papás?
Mis papás, mi mamá de Bogotá, Colombia, y mi papá de Calarcá, Colombia. Entonces los dos colombianos, y ellos son todos para mí. Han sacrificado bastante para mí. Yo quiero ganar tanto dinero en este deporte que los puedo dar todo para ellos. Han sacrificado mucho y un día lo voy a poder repagar a mis papás.
Felicidades por la victoria.
Muchas gracias, amigo.